Hi everybody, this is Mark Beardsley from Ecometrics, and let's reimagine what Riverscapes could be. Start by closing your eyes and imagine a healthy stream. What do you see? Does it look like this? This is what comes to mind for most people I know. A sinuous channel with riffles, pools, and a line of trees or shrubs along the banks. This image of a nice, well-behaved little stream fits neatly into the conceptual models that fluvial geomorphologists developed for us in the 1980s and 90s. The upper one is Stanley Shum's classic channel evolution model, and our stream comes out in stage one. The lower one is the Rosgen River classification system, and our example keys out as C4. Students from the 1990s and early 2000s, my generation, we're taught to use these models to design channels for river restoration. It was called natural channel design, and the purpose was to construct channels that are static, efficient, and in perfect balance. Channels that look like the one in the picture. The goal wasn't a healthy riverscape necessarily. It was a theoretically stable channel, sized perfectly to transport the flows and sediment of its watershed without either a grading or degrading. According to the theory, ideal channels that most efficiently meet this equilibrium point are sized to bankfull discharge, which is roughly about the Q2 flow. Calculating ideal channel form using equations, or copying it from other Q2 channels using a reference reach, is what you do in natural channel design. This cross-section shows the channel dimension of our example stream, neatly designed to contain bankfull discharge, which is the blue line. This is the channel form that theoretically satisfies the physical equations balancing sediment and water discharge according to Lane's balance. It's what my generation of river restoration practitioners was taught to strive for. Now, I shouldn't have probably said that natural channel design aims to create static equilibrium channels instead of healthy riverscapes. It's actually that our generation really believed that static equilibrium channels were healthy riverscapes. We were taught that healthy natural rivers inherently strive for equilibrium and that restoring equilibrium was our way of helping them. I call this the natural equilibrium paradigm, and it dominated for decades. But we don't think that way anymore. There's nothing in the laws of natural science that says natural rivers strive to be efficiently balanced sediment transport channels. The fact is, as Colin just explained to us, that most natural riverscapes don't behave that way at all. A lot of the naturally healthy riverscapes I know look more like this. Lots of biology. Not so much equilibrium. This beautiful mess is anything but static, efficient, and in balance. It's not even a channel. Riverscapes like this retain water and sediment and organic materials. They're complex and inefficient, dynamic and messy. They're wild, and that's what we like about them. And at the same time, they're totally natural and healthy. They're good for you. They're like soup. As an ecologist and lover of nature and plants and animals, it's places like these that get me excited. Soup. But soupy riverscapes like this Anastomose Woody Beaver Complex were not on the river restoration menu back then. They didn't fit the scientific models or the old natural equilibrium paradigm. We couldn't order them up as valid targets for river restoration, at least the way we had been taught. No soup for you! A generation of us learned to think of these complex riverscapes as unstable or out of balance. We wrote them off as anomalies. And this became a huge source of conflict in the river restoration community, especially for practitioners like me and my friends who just couldn't ignore naturally complex, biologically rich riverscapes. So we appealed to higher powers and begged to get soup back on the menu. We even suggested another class to add to the Rosgen system. We called it DB for anastomosing biologically mediated riverscapes. We naively thought that by just adding a category for these systems to the menu, maybe we could bring some harmony back to our rapidly dividing river restoration community. Well, we were wrong. It was bigger than that. Complex dynamic riverscapes just didn't fit with the theory of natural equilibrium that these physical models were based on. So the DB idea was roundly rejected. We felt defeated, of course, but we didn't give up on complex natural riverscapes. Fortunately, river science caught up with river restoration practice. We now have new models that better represent nature in natural riverscapes. That's how natural science works. When enough observations disagree with a theory, it's time to revise the theory. In 2013, Brian Kluwer and Colin Thorne synthesized what river scientists all around the world were discovering. They updated our channel evolution models into a stream evolution model that doesn't presume physical equilibrium. Stage zero acknowledges that natural streams are a little more complex than that. It was a long road, as Colin described, and it was a game changer, a paradigm shift. This is the moment scientists get to shout, "Eureka!" The ramifications for us practitioners are profound. We now recognize complex riverscapes as natural and valuable restoration targets. Thank you, Colin, and to all you other scientists for putting soup back on the menu. See Newman there with his soup? See how happy he is? That was me when I first read Kluwer and Thorne's SEM paper. I think I actually even did a little happy dance. And once you stop thinking of rivers as static channels and admit that streams like this are not anomalies, you realize that naturally complex and wonderfully messy stage zero wetland riverscapes are actually quite common. I think what happened is that the magnitude of riverscape degradation was so widespread, and it occurred so long ago, we just kind of forgot what natural riverscapes could be. Psychologists call this phenomenon generational amnesia. Well, it's time to unforget. It's time to reimagine what natural riverscapes can be. This one's in Cucumber Gulch Preserve near Breckenridge, and it's a designated aquatic resource of national importance by the EPA. And you can read about it as a case study in the Beaver Restoration Guidebook. The point is that riverscapes like this are totally natural and totally awesome. Like Colin said, when it comes to restoration, it's time we think beyond channels and reimagine what riverscapes could be. Restoring the natural stage zero riverscapes, like the one on the left, yields much better aquatic habitat and many more ecosystem services than stabilizing and enhancing stage one channels like the one on the right. It's usually cheaper and easier too. You know why? It's because biologically rich stage zero riverscapes can pretty much restore and maintain themselves. You don't have to design them. Heck, you couldn't even if you tried. They're too complex. And you don't have to build them and keep them maintained. What you do is you help them heal, and the natural processes take over and do the rest. That's what process-based restoration is all about. Okay, I want you to close your eyes again. It's story time. Try to picture the riverscape as I read to you. Looking back some 35 years, we find Trout Creek, a fine mountain stream, banks lined with willows and shrubs, well stocked with mountain trout. The surrounding hills are covered with good stands of pine and fir, and the park's covered with thick grass. Ah. The same section today presents a sadly different picture. The mountain stream has been converted to a deep gully with perpendicular walls and a boulder-strewn bottom. The willows and shrubs are gone. The timber's been cut from the hillsides, and the grass has been replaced by a few stands of ping and sage. The grassy meadows of former years turned into eroded gullies, getting worse each year as summer rains bring down what is left of the once fertile soil. What were once mountain meadows are now barren peat beds. Springs which once furnished water are now dried up. On an area which used to support hundreds of head of cattle, it's now necessary to totally prohibit grazing. You can open your eyes now. Is this what you pictured? Yeah, me too. That's what I pictured when I first read that. But no, this ain't it. This is another stream a few miles away. This is the riverscape I just described. Surprised? Well, what I didn't tell you is that the description I read came from a Civilian Conservation Corps report written in 1933. That was how the river looked back then. This is how the river looks now. In 1933, during the Great Depression, a whole mess of out-of-work dudes descended on Trout Creek with hand tools, willow stems, and whatever materials they could gather on site to try to, in their words, bring back by human effort a portion of what man had destroyed. Totally low-tech. And hats off to you boys, it worked. And it's still working almost a century later. Why do you think it worked so well? I think it's because they had Mother Nature on their side. They enabled natural processes. They got plants and animals and wood and water to do most of the work and long-term maintenance. This is the power of low-tech process-based restoration, and it's nothing new. The same kinds of low-tech treatments still work for the same kinds of reasons. They work when we use them to mimic and promote the natural processes that will take over the job of restoration for us. If these willows grow that these ladies are planting, and if this BDA raises water levels to expand wetland hydrology and create the deep water habitat that attracts beavers, these people have just kicked off natural processes that will work 24/7 toward their restoration goals. That's the process-based part of low-tech PBR. The low-tech part is that you don't need a gazillion dollars of engineering and blueprints to enable natural processes. You don't need to model all the complex interactions going on in a healthy, functioning riverscape ecosystem, which is good because you'd never be able to. Your role is not to design and build the system. It's to diagnose the system stressors and to treat them. The best thing you can do to restore riverscapes is to help them get back to doing their thing the way only they know how to do it. And where I work, that usually means there will be beavers. Ben Goldfarb wrote about the role of beavers in his process-based restoration of riverscapes in this Science magazine article. And later in this workshop, y'all get to hear what Ben learned while writing one of my favorite books of all time, Eager, The Surprising Secret Life of Beavers and Why They Matter. They don't call them keystone species for nothing, you know. Without help from biology, incised streams take centuries or millennia to recover by completing the evolutionary cycle. But as hardworking keystone species, beavers can reduce this time frame to years or decades by either accelerating channel widening and aggradation processes, going around the circle faster to the left, or by directly reversing incision and short-circuiting the cycle, working backwards towards state zero. It just depends on how incised your riverscape has become. Biologically depauperate riverscapes near the bottom of the stream evolution triangle are controlled primarily by physics. Stream power, bank cohesion, sediment entrainment, stuff like that. As a result, you get simple streams like the one at the bottom that maintains form largely by equilibrium between sediment deposition and scour. This works, but biological processes overcome these simple physical relations to build and maintain complex habitats like the stage zero riverscape up here near the green corner of the triangle. And this works because living things, including beavers, have a wonderful capacity to fight entropy. They process energy to create and maintain complex systems by just being there and striving to survive and reproduce. The natural equilibrium paradigm was flawed in several ways, but its biggest Achilles heel is that it didn't account for biology. Even if it were valid, it would only make sense on the bottom row of this triangle. There's way more to riverscapes than dirt and water. In nature, biological factors drive riverscape form and function as much as physical factors do. We can't keep ignoring that. And now we don't have to. Now we can actually use that to restore healthy and complex riverscapes. Colorado State University researchers Ellen Wall and Deanna Laurel describe it as a positive biological feedback loop up here. Wetland vegetation provides food for beavers, who also use it to create dams, which create backwaters and overbank flows that support wetland, that supports vegetation, that supports the beavers, who build the dams, that support the wetland, that supports the vegetation, that supports the beavers, who, well, you get the picture. When these biological processes shut down, simple physical processes take over in another feedback loop that maintains the simple equilibrium channelized form. Think of this upper loop like a biological engine that provides the energy to maintain complex systems. Process-based restoration employs these biological engines to do most of their work. It's really all very zen when you think about it. And when you get to thinking about it like this, restoration of these riverscapes is really all about getting that biological engine up and running. It's about applying treatments that promote these natural processes. In the case of beaver systems, if your site doesn't have the proper native woody vegetation, maybe you can plant it or help it grow by managing land use. And if you're not getting enough saturation, maybe you can raise the water table with a BDA. And of course, if you want the engine to keep running, you better have a plan to get beavers back. It works. I've seen it. It doesn't happen overnight, and it may take a lot of persistence and adaptive management on your part. But if you can promote the processes that keep these biological engines going, they'll do most of the restoration work for you. Here's a site we worked on in 2008. And here it is after vegetation got reestablished in 2016, following dramatic change in land use and a lot of planting. And here it is in 2020 after the beavers found it. You too can bring a healthy riverscape back to life as long as you've got a little help from your friends. Reimagine what's possible. Thank you.